Hello again, and welcome back to the shop and Charlemagne's Clock. We've been talking about problems at the Boeing company and working toward some fixes. Today we're going to talk about the last big problem. And this is an engineering problem. This isn't a management problem except as it involves the engineering managers. In our society, when we have a behavioral issue with people, it's always the law that gets involved first. We pass a law that outlaws something and then figure out what the penalties should be. Then, after the lawyers are involved, the legal process and the politicians, then the psychologists come along and try to classify it, and so that if possible, they can diagnose and treat it. So what I'm going to lay out today is something that neither the lawyers or the psychologists have jumped into yet. And I don't know how the psychologists will classify it. I don't know what the legal approach should be. I know what the engineering management problem is, and we can describe it. It's a behavior which is easily identified and described, and which meets the qualifications that the legal process and the psychologists find interesting, because it leads to one of the things they care about, which is either self-harm or harm to others. In this case, it's harm to others usually, although if you're present at the wrong time, if the developer's present at the wrong time, they can be harmed as well. And it exists on a spectrum. The harm can be as little as an irritating inconvenience or can kill a lot of people. And in the case of Boeing, it's killed a lot of people. I call it excessive software dependency spectrum disorder, ESDSD. So what is it? It is the use of software to solve a hardware problem when you shouldn't. There is a strong tendency to use software if you can, as opposed to building hardware, because hardware costs a lot more. The development costs are very similar, provided you don't include the one of the standard procedures in engineering testing, which is something for safety critical systems, which is called failure mode analysis or failure mode and effects analysis. That step can be incredibly expensive in the case of software. But with the exception of that little element, development costs can be very similar between hardware and software. The big difference is in the cost of production. The incremental cost of software is practically zero. Incremental cost of hardware is significant, and we'll get into that. So that's today's discussion, is about a mental disorder of engineers and especially engineering managers, how it comes about, and how to recognize it, and pointing out that we need to do something about it. And what to do about it is to get good engineering managers who understand it and can't steer away from it. So let's jump in. This current episode is about an intersection of human behavior as it applies to engineers and something that's happened in the technology, which makes this behavior potentially, doesn't have to be, but it makes it potentially extremely dangerous. It's a combination of the Jurassic Park syndrome.
A What species is this?
It's a velociraptor.
Before. Yeah, but your scientists were so preoccupied with whether or not they could, they didn't stop to think if they should.
And what's happened in the computer world with ever more capable chips, it's difficult to imagine the numbers and the impact of the numbers that are involved in the increase in density, or the raw numbers of integrated circuit components, electronic components, transistors, capacitors, and so on, that are inside an electronic circuit that have find themselves instantiated using silicon in a chip. Because of this and an economic factor, there's been a trend to do things in software that one should not. There's Scott Adams in one of his Dilbert books made the observation that engineers love to solve problems. And if they can't find a problem if they don't have a problem to solve in front of them, they'll go and find one. And that's exactly true. And this has been made fun of or observed in various ways over the years, for example.
And they probably redesigned the whole sick bay too. I know engineers, they love to change things.
So let's take a look at a couple of cost realities. When engineers design something using hardware, you have a development cost. You ramp up your development costs, and then late in the process, as you get into test, the costs start to come down. Then you move into production. Your production has, you see, you have to set up a physical assembly line, and your production has a cost, and then your manufacturing engineers, your production people, gradually get better at it over time, and over time, your costs of production do come down, but it's a slow, gradual process, and they never go to zero. They're always substantial. Whereas with software, you have your development costs, and again, you have your test period, and then when you get ready to go to production, your costs practically go to zero. The cost of each incremental unit of software, you get storage. You got to do whatever it takes to connect, either through a website or some sort of a software loading process. But other than that, I mean, it's just, that's noise. That's pennies at most. So you've got effectively zero marginal costs for software. So what this does for management, who doesn't know anything about engineering, it causes them to say or ask a question of your engineering management team, well, can't you do more of that stuff in software? And this is where engineering management needs to be highly disciplined. One of the most important qualifications to be an engineering manager is to know when not to ask your engineering team whether or not they can do something. Again, remember Dr. Malcolm. So busy trying to figure out whether or not you can that people forget to ask whether or not they should. This is a big issue. And a good engineering manager has to know when not to ask that question, because the engineers, they just love to solve problems. I mean, they're on them like a dog on a bone. And if you ask, hey, can you do X? Without even thinking about it, they start noodling on, well, how would we do X? This encounters another cost item that when Ben Thompson draws these charts, He's a well-known and respected commentator in areas of technology and technology business. Has a newsletter called Stratechery and a podcast. And he does, he's a partner with another fellow, and one of the podcasts is called Sharp Deck. And a safety critical system, whether it's flight controls or launch controls in a missile silo, which is something I worked on. You do something, one of your engineering steps is called the failure mode analysis. Now, in the commercial airplane company, or in the commercial airplane business, failure mode analysis is usually they stick another word in there, failure mode and effects analysis. It's both the same thing. It's you analyze your solution for everything that can go wrong. So make a detailed list of all possible failure modes. And then once you have that list, and when I was working on the ICBM system, the list of things that could go wrong in a missile silo was several thousand items. And so a detailed analysis of every last one of those items had to be done. And you had to ensure that the design established what's known as a fail-safe condition. When a failure occurred, it failed safe. Nothing bad happened. I remember on Peacekeeper program for example, when we did failure mode analysis, it was discovered we had a condition when if a particular failure occurred, you might accidentally command a missile to launch into the lid of the silo if the silo lid hadn't blown off. So we had to fix that. So you want to find and correct these kinds of conditions. But as the number of line items in your software code goes up, the number of individual line items requiring failure mode analysis skyrockets. It's a geometric relationship. And at some point, in effect, the cost of the failure mode analysis goes to infinity. The number of items, the number of possible failure conditions becomes so large that you can't do the job. Now, there's a way to manage for this. And what you do is you break your software up into pieces and run them on separate pieces of hardware, in effect breaking things down, but that's back into hardware. In effect, you build a moat or barrier around each of your software modules such that you can do the FMA, the failure mode analysis, and develop a certainty that you have fail-safe conditions for every possibility. So what happened on the 737 MAX? My friend Bob Bogash, he got together with some of his friends. He was a 737 pilot. He spent his entire career on the program, customer support. He was head of quality at one point and so on. He consulted with a lot of people, put together an input to the FAA. He wrote a letter, and I'll provide a link in the description below. And he goes into great detail about things that can go wrong in flight controls when they're automated and when you introduce a lot of automation. And he makes the observation that in this hybrid system that the 737 MAX became, the failure mode analysis, failure mode effects analysis was inadequate. And the answer, what I would observe to that is, of course it was inadequate because it was an impossible task and they decided not to do the work. They had combined too many system components which put too much software into a single box, too many functions into a single box. And as a result of that, they created a physical condition in which it was impossible to even list all of the things that could go wrong, let alone do an individual proper analysis and then tweak your design to account for all possible failure modes. Just do the work. So if you had had competent, ethical engineering leadership, that wouldn't have happened, because they would not have allowed the overall system design to have too few physical components. They would have had more hardware in there. Might have had just as much software, but the software would have been segmented such that they could produce it in a manner in which the FMA, the failure mode analysis, could have been done adequately, and they ensured it. So why didn't they have that? So those are some harsh words. We'll see if they make the final cut of this tape. If they didn't, you can be assured I said some things that were pretty strong about Boeing's C-suite. Anyway, that's the problem. If you have a requirement in a safety critical system that calls for the use of software, you want to make sure that you do not put too many functional elements of your software. It doesn't matter how big they are. You want to make sure that you don't put too many of them together in the same box, such that if those boxes fail, or the software in one of them starts acting up or behaving in a way that was unexpected, that you can cut it out of the system. The word off has to mean off, as in power off, it's not there anymore. And when it's not there, the condition that exists without it has to be okay. It has to fail safe. The operators need to be able to safely control the system. That's what basic fail-safe design calls for. And that's what's not in the MAX. What they did in the MAX, and I'll put a little illustration up, is down in the EE bay, that's under the floor of the flight deck in the forward section of the forward cargo bay, where there are these electronic racks. And as a cost cutting, they started combining boxes, LRUs, we call them, line replaceable units. And this maneuvering characteristics augmentation system, which had been in a separate box when it was developed in the 767 and didn't do all that much, suddenly became just a software module in the flight control computer, along with the autopilot and along with some of the basic controls that need to be there all the time. So, and there were so many lines of code that a thorough failure mode analysis simply was humanly impossible to perform. So they didn't do it. That's the problem. Now, the people whose expertise is the design of flight controls, which is not me. I'm a systems architect, and I know a little bit about fail-safe design. I used to teach a class on failure mode analysis. But people whose expertise is these flight control systems, like my friend Bob Bogash, they understand at a very fine level of detail what the component interaction or subsystem interaction issues are. And I'll leave that to them. I'm not making any comments on that. But the overall system architecture, even not knowing anything about the detailed design of flight controls, one glance at it tells me that it's dangerous. Dangerous as designed in a very fundamental way. And as far as I can tell, none of the fixes have addressed that. The problem with systems complexity is once you get beyond the ability to do a proper failure mode analysis, you still don't know what beasties are lurking in there to raise their head at some future time. When, you know, you're not expecting what conditions can crop up that just never occurred to anyone. And when they do crop up, will the flight crew be able to handle it? These are questions which you just can't know the answer to until they actually happen. Because of the overall architecture of the system. And that's a result of this thing that I call excessive software dependency spectrum disorder. Doing things too much in software and trying to cut corners on your LRU count or your hardware design. Thank you very much. I hope you're getting something out of this and enjoying it. I hope it's informative. If you want to support what I'm doing here, again, press the like button, subscribe. The thing that would actually help the most is to share the links laterally through your messaging or email or whatever texting apps you use on a daily basis. Moving it around like that, posted in social media, that sort of thing. That's what really builds a channel, because right now I'm at a kind of a noise level in terms of the YouTube algorithms. They're interested in selling advertising. Again, thank you very much. Hope to see you next time back here on Charlemagne's Clock, where we'll dig into fixes and things that can be done to make things better. Thank you.